lay it out. I'm trying to return to like making up some cardboard patterns and just getting a rough idea of pretty much what I want to get done today. If I can, is get the dashboard, the panel made up. Now, this was just something that I eyeballed in the other day, which then evolved into a more realistic pattern. Now I'm real close. I know where this has to be bigger and smaller, and I want to make it a little bit oversized right now. But the next step here is to cut this piece out of 64th plywood. Now I want to have the grain going for the first original piece, the grain going side to side. Now the hard part is I have to figure a way of holding this in position. Usually a point of a number 11 blade is good. And try to wiggle this in position and see where it's a little too big or a little too small and do the trimming. Now the problem is when you go to put this in and it's plywood, it's difficult to wiggle it into position, but I did find a couple areas where I have to relieve it. Little by little, I just keep chipping away at it till it fits in. Then if I've gone too far, I can mark this spot and just make another piece. Now you can see when you go to put this in, you get one set and now, alright, it's hitting. Now, so the trick is just like sheetrock work, get in there and mark with a little pen or something where it's hitting. Whoops. And wherever it's hitting, just keep chipping away. You can see what I've been doing here is just chipping away, chipping away, chipping away. And it's totally changed the whole of one side. Now, it may seem like it's a real simple thing. It was a time-consuming thing. You can see now there's spots, I don't know if you can see with the light in here, where the, I need to make this a little bit bigger, so obviously I'm going to have to make another pattern. I guess there's a trick. There's a lot of tricks to a professional pattern maker, how he would do this. Let's see if you can see any of these. You can see it's really not as tight as I'd like, and I want this to become a former. I don't want this just going along for the ride. I also need, if you see the way the push rod is moving, I need to get some clearance on that. So I'll make all those little adjustments and make up another pattern. Now, what I did is I took a red pen. You can see the red pen here, and I need to make this part a little bit bigger. These are the spots. Boy, I bet you somebody that's a real pattern maker out there, somebody that does this for a living, is probably saying, what a crude guy he is. Anyway, I need to make this just a little bit bigger, but that's the whole point. None of us are really professional. Or at least none of us admit we're not professional. Now, I know that piece is okay. That piece is okay. I know this dimension up here is pretty close. And see, there's two goals I have here. One of the goals is, by the way, I'm reversing the grain here until I get this right because I can bend it and get it in a little bit easier. And then when I get a final pattern, I can use this, the one with the grain backwards here, or the grain going in the wrong direction, as a pattern. I can send that out to Bob Martens. But now imagine, when this is on the plans and you go to do this, since you've made it from this shell as a molded shell and everything, this piece should fit right in theory anyway. Now you can see I've got almost everything, except I don't have the tunnel. The push rod is a little too close. I need to bring that tunnel over. Now I guess I'll use this for my pattern, but I'll make another one up. I'm missing a little gap up there. I really want to have this add some stiffness to the fuselage. I don't want any of this stuff just going along for the ride. I want to make up what I hope will be the final part here. Now one of the things I figured is I estimated this a little incorrectly, and now I can put that in correctly. This is the push rod range. I know I have this. Let's just see the things I know I have right. I have this right, and I have this right. This I don't have right. This I know I have right. By the way, this is really, you know, you may laugh, and you're thinking, well, there must be a more professional way to do this. I don't know if there really is. Now, see, I have a piece here. I know I have to add material here to get that to come down right. And even if I have to make a couple more, this is... The world isn't going to end. There's a little notch in here. And out this way, there's a little notch. But this is going to be one of the focal points of the plane, and I sure don't want to compromise it. Now notice now on the good piece, I have the grain going sideways. Now I hope I can get that in there and I can force it in place and I can start figuring out the instrument locations then. Now you can get a little idea of how this part evolved. And there's the final part right there with all the final cuts and curves in it, and it's really a good fit. So if you can pick up from the video some way of making these patterns, I think it'll be a big help to you somewhere in the illustrious model career you're going to have. I know this is a finalized part and it's really a good fit. I have the proper clearance down here. What I want to do is laminate this onto another piece of 64th plywood with the grain going in this direction. This way it'll be nice and strong. Remember, I'm trying to use this as a former. I don't want this just to go along for the ride. And you want to laminate two pieces of 64th plywood or any kind of hardwood. Give it a light sanding on both surfaces. And this is the whole thing that I found works well. And use the slow CA. The easiest way, remember, is always to glue the first part to the second part and then trim it. Now in this case I'll do this with a jigsaw and then finish it off with a Dremel tool. Grain going this way, grain going this way. This will be a real nice rigid part and it'll be very light. Okay, we got it double grain now, all trimmed out and it fits in perfectly. Now after all that tinkering, we have a really good fit. I have the plan made up for Bob Martens. Come on, come out. Look at this, nothing else. That's the kind of fit I want on this. Because I want this piece actually to not just be going along, I keep saying this over and over, not just be going along for the ride. Now, if you bought a set of plans and you had this piece on there, you would just have saved yourself 2 or 3 hours of what I just did on the tape. Now this is a picture of a real Spitfire instrument layout. Obviously we're not going to be able to make a perfect scale replica of this, but just to capture some of the idea, the flavor, the look of it. Now this is from the Seafire book. This is actually a Seafire dashboard here. And it lists underneath it, if you can see it here, it lists all the different things by number, so you can kind of figure out what knob or switch is what. This will be a big help, but remember, and I'm trying to keep this, you know, realistic here. First off, we have a giant push rod running down the middle of this. We're just trying to capture a little bit of the flavor of roughly what this would look like. You remember during Midgley's visit, last time Midgley, we made up an envelope called Cockpit Stuff. And what we did is we took the instruments and had them shrunken and enlarged and changed in shape. You can do this with a copying machine, so you can see there's all different sizes and scales. So what I'm going to do, obviously, is go through here. Here's some nice big ones, nice big fat ones. These are going to definitely be too big. I can eliminate them. In fact, I'll probably be looking at the smallest ones, which are, we had these go down in scale. World War II instruments, okay. Again, if you buy one of these JTEC things, good tip, save yourself. These sell, by the way, for $8.50. And all you need to do is go to a copying machine, go to a Staples, have them do it bigger, 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 small, 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 smaller, and you wind up with a real nice set of instruments. Let's just hope these are going to be kind of the scale size. But see, I can lay my piece out here, but the problem is there's a reality to this whole thing. First of all, it's not a scale model. You can see the real model is higher and thinner than we are, wider and shorter, because of where the wing is in the real plane. So I'm going to have to do a little bit of fudging here, and I'm going to have to try to make myself up relative to the size instruments available. Some kind of a semi-scale layout here, and this will just be one of those like an interpolation thing. By the way, it's real interesting. I don't know if you can see. Arrestor hook indicator light. I don't know if you can see any of this. Some of the switches and gauges and dots, this is what I love about books. I love about knowing this stuff. You know, if you really want to know it, great. You know, it's not an ego trip. It's just like you know it. And it's just one of the things you know, and you can kind of take some pride in the fact that you've got this knowledge. When you're building a model, it's easy to reference off it. What I always do is mark which side is the front, which is the back, because it's not a 90-degree flip-flop when you do this. Oh, believe me, this,
this may look real easy on video, this is difficult to try to figure out, well, what this would really look like when it's in this position. Again, you're limited, I'm limited anyway, and this is exactly what I can really do here. But I will try to get, yeah, some representation, something close anyway. It looks like basically there's three different sizes of dials, and I've tried to just roughly, I can't put the gun sight in, I'm not going to simulate that, so I moved the whole dashboard up and try to get a similar amount or size or style of instrumentation there.
And the next thing is to get a Dremel tool and just burn these holes in with a grindstone. It's almost impossible to cut them or drill them, they need to just be burned right in.
Thing about using a pointed grindstone, you can do any size hole. You just go further and further in. So I can do all the holes with one, hopefully with one shot here. And I literally just burn away through. Good idea too, from the back side, and again that's why I always mark the back, just take a dowel with some sandpaper, clean up the edges. Now, you know, when we did the Strega canopy and we did other canopies, this is not the first one. I try to use a little bit different technique on each one so that if somebody's interested in, let's say, a real simple painted on canopy, hey, we got plenty of them. If somebody wants like the Strega canopy, let's see if we can do it in one day special. Well, we have that on video, but this is the one that's probably a little more, this is probably 2 or 3 days of kind of intensive work to get this the way I want it.
I want to make sure even the instrument location is kind of like shown on the plans, and I'm sure Bob will did a hell of a job on a Spitfire. I did him a rough and a detail, so we have both. This should even show, I guess, in some way, show the instrument locations. Again, that's the difference when you're doing something that there's always a cheaper way to do it, always an easier way, always a less labor-intensive way, and you really have a lot of choices. There's no reason to get this involved unless you're really trying for the maximum realism you can squeeze out of a real stunt plane, a real world-class stunt plane. And it's not easy. If it was easy, everybody'd have this. Next step is, if you notice on all different sandpaper, each one has a little bit of a different gray, or this is kind of a dark gray. This really does simulate the matte finish that a dashboard would have. So what I'm going to do is get some thick CA, spread it out real nice and evenly, and get it glued down on there. What I need to do here is just trim it out with a nice sharp number 11 blade and then burn in the holes. Now what I'll do, I'll start burning from one side. Otherwise what will happen if you try to burn this all at once, you can't really lay out your instrument location on the side that the sandpaper's on. So you kind of have to do it in reverse, then flip it over and do the final little kiss each side just to clean off that edge. That is a saying that I always remember from a long time ago. I don't remember where I heard it, but for everything in life you take, you have to leave something behind. And the significance of that right here is, we've put all this work into having a sliding canopy. One of the things we'll get as a benefit of this is if any of these instruments loosen up, or if something, the pilot loosens up, any of the knobs loosen up, well, we can slide the canopy back and get in there and work on it. Where normally, when you have sealed up the canopy, the day you put it on and then the pilot's head comes off, or his glasses come off, or his who the hell knows what, his fly is open, you're married to it. So there is a little benefit to all this extra work we're doing. The things you're going to have to wind up doing is a couple of times is getting that ridge and go back to the burnishing tool
run it through again. It takes her two or three times to get the holes nice and clean. You can feel the high spots with your finger. And believe me, you think these little details aren't worth doing. Somebody walks by your plane and they look in the cockpit and they see those glass reflections from the instruments. Usually that'll just blow somebody away. And they wonder how you did it. So you want to do the same thing to the back too. You don't want to have all those hairs or threads or whatever you want to call them just hanging in there. And it takes a little time to dress these edges off, but well worth it. Again, once we put the glass in here, well worth it. I was in a hobby shop with Jimmy the other day, and I saw what they have for RC planes is dashboards that are already made up. Obviously none in the scale that we use. Heaven forbid they should ever make anything we could use, but it would be a dashboard with all the little glasses in place and everything. Real nice if you're making a 20-foot wingspan model.
Follow your star. Be brave.
The next thing I have to figure out is I need to get the piece that I'm going to use for the glass on the instruments. What I really would like to have is a piece of this stuff flat. And I didn't think enough ahead to tell Dave that's what I wanted. That would be the perfect piece of glass. I don't have it. So I thought of some of the other choices. I went into my box of canopies here. These are all the ones Dave molded up in the past. I look for one that has at least a big enough flat spot on it. Even a cardinal canopy, I don't think that has enough flat spot on it. Oh, that does. I hate to cut up that canopy, so what I did, I looked in my, I don't even know what I had this for. At one time, I guess we were molding stuff out of this. I don't even know what this is, some kind of plastic from Mountain Pictures or something. But it looks like it's got the nice reflective quality that I'd like to have. See, what I'd like to have is, as these instruments go through the sun, I want to see that flicker of light. And you'd be surprised how effective that is at catching somebody's eye when they're, especially when they're appearance judging, and you're trying to distract the fact away from them that you have lumpy fillets or something. That little flash of sunlight is what does it. See, if I move around here, I'm in an awkward spot. See how the light shines off of the instruments? It'll just come and go. Right there. That's what really, to me, is the ultimate effect I'm looking for.
And in the Red Baron, you can see, well, it's hard to see with all the stuff in the way. But you can see that really did have a nice little look in the cockpit.
I just took a piece of 16th balsa and traced out roughly where the instruments are going to go. Get a rough idea. Now I can cut them out and one by one, just drop them into position.
Leaving me with...
What I try to do is get one drop of thick CA on there.
I'm not
and of course, I don't want to get the instruments all crooked.
Good night, sweetheart. I want you to know that my love will always guide you.
Now you're the jury.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm
gone for three or four.
And you gotta carefully get this lined up, make sure it's lined up. Not going to glue it yet, because what I want to do, I want to get that glass piece made up. So I can pull some of this off of here. And then obviously what I want to do is get this on top of that. And that gives it the final look. You know, that's roughly how big it is, but I don't need the glass all the way out here, so I'm just going to trim with about
giving myself, say, a 1/16 of an inch edge around the whole perimeter. Okay, now I can lay out this piece of plexiglass, whatever you want to call it, get that shape. This way we're trimming away all that extra weight which would just go along for the ride. Fanatical, huh? You can see what happened, and this is a good lesson to learn. This is the kind of lessons you learn. I sawed this out with the Dremel tool, and there apparently was still a little bit of the uncured slow CA in there, and it just melted the instrument. So now, obviously what I have to do is go right back to square one, and this happens to everybody. This is why I put everything on a video, so you don't feel bad if this ever happens to you. I'll lay this out again with the dial, do this off camera, because I'll lay this out with the same circles. Luckily, I have plenty of instruments, and just redo the whole thing. Now, the key here is now I'm not going to use the, I see there's a problem with the slow CA. I need to get a different kind of glue that won't melt the instruments. Live and learn, baby. Live and learn. It happens to everybody.
Well, I did. I don't know if this is really going to work either, but I like to share all these little experiments. Let me get all this stuff off the paper. Here's what I did. I tried some Will Hold glue because I wanted to see if it would dry clear, just in case some got in behind the instruments, and to see if it was good and solid. Well, it really isn't dry. In fact, it's delaminating the paper, so I guess it's going to be plenty strong enough. So what I'm going to try to do, I traced out these on a piece of colored, you know, notebook paper. I'm just going to try to make this up while this is drying, just to see if this is going to be a viable way to do it. Now, the other time, what I might have run into is some plexiglass that you can see the glue really doesn't like this plexiglass. Even a kicker melts it. So maybe this is some cheap shit. I don't even know where I got this from. But I may try cutting up one of those canopies as an alternative, even if I have to cut up a good canopy.
Glue over the whole area, and I'm just going to drop the instruments in one by one. Again, nothing deters me. If this doesn't work, I'll make a third and a fourth and a fifth or a tenth one. I don't care. When you have a little bit of a setback, hey, no problem. I had a cup of coffee. I feel better already. Actually, I need a beer is what I need. Karen doesn't let me drink beer, though. The easiest way to get these in position, of course, is with a... If I put that on a taper rated number 11 blade, cut them all out ahead of time and just drop them in. Make sure you got them in the right angles. Nothing worse than having 12 o'clock at the bottom of a clock or something like that. I always cut one or two extra ones out because you never know when your one's going to drop on the floor and a mouse will run out and get it or something, and then you're stuck right in the middle of the job. Okay, now this is tight bond glue, so we're going to see if this works. This is any amount of an improvement. To show you how desperate I'm getting, I looked all over the house for a piece of... I looked at the canopies, and they're not really any good because they always have a curve somewhere that I can't use. So Midgley, send me a couple of flat pieces for next year. Anyway, we got this. This looks like a gift of something. I don't know what the hell it even is. Wine? Double liqueur? Well, you know what? It's going to be double canopy now. Say goodbye, nice liqueur. How can I get this package open? Anyway, this is how you have to improvise as you go along. I guess there's a lesson in that somewhere. Hey, maybe while I'm sitting here I can get drunk too. Boy, Karen hates it when I do that. Anyway, look at that. We have a nice big piece of cockpit material of something. I have no idea what this is. Let's see if it works. Obviously some kind of glue works well on this plastic. Then before I do my dashboard, I don't want to screw up the dashboard. I need to run some kind of a little test here. Let me take a little piece.
I guess this is, hey, what can I tell you? This is half of the fun. If nothing else, this will be a little bit lighter, the material's lighter. I just thought I could really capture that three-dimensional look by having the instruments a little bit further back. And I won't even bother making it smaller than the dashboard, the material is so light. Let me see this. And I guess this is half of the fun. I don't know why I'm getting depressed about this. I guess what I really wanted to do was get this finished today, but you know what? Sometime it just doesn't work out that way. It's a good idea to save the extra material and put it all, whether this works or not, I want to have all this stuff in one envelope for the next lucky cockpit that we have to make. Always a good idea to store it, and just like Letrosets and stuff, store it all in one envelope. What I decided to do, because this material is thin, one of the advantages I have now, try to mix up some 5-minute epoxy and do this. What the hell, I got string in here. Try to mix some 5-minute epoxy up. The idea is to keep it from bubbling in by the instruments, and I'm going to have to be real careful about not getting any in there. Again, I've learned a valuable lesson, which I'm glad I can pass on to you. Now, I don't know if this is really going to be exactly what I want to do here, but again, seems like this would be a good way to do it, but I don't want to have any big bubbles of epoxy up here. That's what happened with the other one. It wound up getting squeezed inside the instrument. I mean, this isn't like a wing spar that it's falling apart or anything, so no real strength here. I just want to make this as neat as possible. What I did, I got the glass gluing to the back of the dashboard. But when you line this up now, and I guess I wasn't as accurate as I should be, I can still see the edges of the instruments, but there's a good trick to that too. And I know because I screwed this up a couple times already. What you can do is just take each instrument and take a black pen and go around it. And by doing that, it disguises the fact that the instrument might be a little bit off-center, just a little bit. This one here is just not perfect, and that's a good way to avoid having to do the whole thing over. In effect, it makes the instrument just a little bit bigger. I think there was two. It was this one and this one is just a little bit off. And I guess it's just, maybe it's the way I cut them out, just being sloppy or something. But anyway, this lets you salvage it. Well, of course, the other choice is you could just put it, I'm running out of small instruments. I could put the other instrument right on top of this if I wanted to. Now what I did, I cut this out. One of the things I want to do now, I want to go trace this out on another piece of paper that's the thickness of the instruments, so that what happens is I don't have these instruments, they're sticking up the thickness of a paper, a couple of thousandths, and it's going to give this a warped look. I'd like these all to be perfectly flat, so what I have to do is cut a piece of paper out of this that's this thickness. Now when I laid this out, I guess I was wrong again. I'm getting used to being wrong here. I tried to add the thickness because I didn't want the instruments to look like they were all coming up on mountaintops, but it looks like this is going to be okay. It looks like it has about the look I'd like too. So now all I need to do is get some epoxy and epoxy that around the edge with maybe a dot in between, so this obviously doesn't go after years and years get dried up from ultraviolet and break up on me. And what I'm trying to do is get just enough epoxy in here that this will hold this in place, and I'll hope, in addition to this, I'll put some scotch tape on the back. I don't want so much that it's going to smear into the instruments though. In
just trying to make sure the instruments have a decent alignment here anyway. It has that wear, that little way that it catches the light. Now, I just have a rough fit here. Again, another dry fit. I want to make sure, number one, let's see if you can see that pushrod clearance. And now I can start, even though that's in there loose, I can start to figure out where the pilot is and where the rest of my details are going to go. I want to see if I can get a little bit of angle in the dashboard. Just rake it, oops, hey, oopsie, don't fall down. And I need to make some kind of a block or something for him to sit on. But now I can look, and I can see part of the side here. I can get some detailing in the side. And I can put a floor in there now.
I don't know, Ski, if it's you are such a cool guy, it wouldn't take you so long to do this.
You're right, it is taking time, but it is worth it. Things I've done in the past is use sandpaper for the floor, and of course I can try different grits so it's a contrast with the dashboard. I like to get the darkest sandpaper I can for that. Now you can see the effect. This is 500 sandpaper. Oh no, I'm sorry, this is the 180. You can see it has the look of a texture that would be pretty realistic. Now of course this isn't in there permanently. I'm just trimming away the little extra to make sure I don't have any interference with the push rod. Okay, now next thing I'm going to do is put a little mark with a dashboard and a seat end so I can paint these sides or do something to detail these sides. I sure don't want to see that wood there.
Now this is the paint we had. Look, I even got it marked, Spitfire Canopy. I had mixed this up. This is talcum powder and some of the custom SIG colored dope that we had from last year from the Spitfire. Basically it's supposed to simulate zinc oxide, and what I want to do is make sure it's got enough talcum powder in it that it dries, well, that it dries kind of dull anyway, not shiny. Now I pulled the back off the seat, number one. What I need to do is get this side of this painted. I don't know if I'm going to paint this green or black yet. I think I'm going to hold off on this. I'm not sure if I want to paint this the zinc oxide color or not, but I do want to get inside the canopy now.
Now you can see I drew a line, so I know just how far back I have to paint here.
But what I really realized here, like it or not, the pilot's head, part of it is going to be supported by this. So I want to strengthen this up a little bit if I can. This is 16th plywood. And what I tried to do is lay this out. And what I'm going to do is try to make a doubler would be the right word here. I'll cut this piece out. And then try to put some simulated lightning holes in it. Now actually I made two of these up. I wasn't happy with the first one. I'm just putting on some CA. The idea of that is it'll stiffen up. If we have to ultimately attach the pilot's head to that, it'll give it some support. Now I like to harden up all these parts with thin CA, because this part actually is going to do some work. Okay, now what I need to do is notch this back out so that I can get a good glue joint there, a nice kind of a dovetail joint. That's the next thing. Again, I want to have that kind of a furniture joint deal here. Whoops. Now, I want to mix me up just a little bit here of just a couple of brushfuls. Sig Black with some talcum powder. A little bit of thinner in here. Again, it doesn't pay to mix too much of this ahead of time, just for doing a little detailing. Just enough thinner that it'll paint without being glocky. That would probably near the end of what I'm going to be able to get done today. I'm making all these little details. I will tell you one thing, my eyes go bad. Go blind working on this stuff. Again, I made this kind of thin because with the talcum powder, I want to get some bond on that first coat anyway. Being I'm probably going to have the pilot's head glued to this. This is where you wish you had hands like George Venturini puts that little lettering in the fire engine pictures. Oh, man. Freedom's just another word for nothing left to lose. Nothing. The last thing I'll do today, I guess, is I'll get a dry fit on this. Put everything back in a plane once this dries and just make sure everything still fits the way I envisioned it. My great master plan here. I'm going to let this dry and give it another couple of coats. Okay, I guess that's a good start, but that's all we're going to get done tonight, so see you in the morning. Now, one of my friends from Spain, I hope I'm saying this name right, Jose Javier Rodriguez Hernandez. Sounds like a phone book. Get shorter names. How about Ertnowski? That's a great name. Anyway, sent me a couple of pictures from Spain showing the activity at the flying field. By the way, talk about a nice flying field. Nice Magnum, too. And he's one of the people I hope will be ordering a Cardinal kit real soon. Let's hope so, anyway. Also, in the same mail, we got a card from Jim Borelli. This is really cute. This is his daughter. Of course, we were at the party. This is his daughter. Baby Lena is her name. Now, look, this is great. Now, tell me you don't love this picture.
Yeah, you better win the Nats, Ertnowski, you Polak.
Anyway, thanks a lot.
Back to the shop. Let's see if we can do some canopy work today.
This is something Karen and I pick up each year at the craft store, like it's a Lee Ward's or a Michael's or whatever the hell it is. And they make all different sizes. What you can see by the reference to my finger, they're little tiny jewels. And what I want to do is simulate where they have the landing gear up light and whatever the other lights are that would normally be on a dashboard. And you can see what I have to do is get a little tiny drill a hole in here real carefully, and set these in with epoxy, and it's really a lot harder than you think it is without making it a messy job. I don't know if you can see in there, we do have some, I think two or three of them are in the Spitfire itself, so. Anyway, that is one of the things I really like. I know the Red Baron, let's see. Hard to focus in on this stuff. Yeah, there's a couple of jewels in there too. Anyway, that's one of the things I want to work on this morning. Have a very short session here, only an hour or so, but I can take care of one or two little details. This morning I also put a second coat of paint in there. I also painted around the spot that I thought you would see. I guess you can't see it from this angle. There's a spot behind the push rod where when you lay the seat in, you can kind of see behind it, so I painted that flat black. Just trying to get one coat on everything. And the idea of laying all this stuff out is, it's like making a little jigsaw puzzle, and then when it finally comes time to put it together, everything will just, in theory, this is the kind of thing you hope will work. Now remember, one of the things I'm trying, you know, this is the pilot, of course, he's in flat, dull colors. So anything I do paint, I'm putting a little bit of talcum powder in the paint. I want to make sure when it dries to a flat finish. I don't want any, you know, buffed out finish inside the cockpit. Because in a real plane, you would have that anti-glare paint all over inside the plane, and the part that would be zinc oxide really doesn't have a shine. So I'm trying to make sure. Now, if this color is too bright, I don't want it to look all plasticky. I want it to look dull, just like the pilot. In fact, what had happened is when I put the first coat on, it really did look a little too light. I went back, put a little black in the paint to darken it up, but... Now, this is really where it gets to be high-tech. Now, what I did, I drilled three holes through here, and what I'm trying to do, using a toothpick, just make sure they're nice and smooth. You'd be surprised how a little detail like this really stands out. Now, what I'm going to do, I'm going to take a little bit of slow-drying epoxy on the end of a toothpick and just put a very small layer of it in there, just the slightest little bit. Then I'm going to pick this up. Now, I tried several ways in the past of picking this up. What happens if you just wet the end of a toothpick? You see, you can pick it up on a toothpick. Oop. Yeah, sure you can. And that drill is a 93,000 drill, and these rhinestones are 93,000, so they'll sit right in there. And when that sun hits them, they'll look real nice. Let me mix up some epoxy. Now, you may be thinking, well, you could use thick CA or thin CA or whatever, but believe me, you know how it ruined that plastic? I've fooled around, and if you get one little drop of CA on that sandpaper surface, it looks terrible. So, another thing too, mixing up small amounts of epoxy like this, this is 5 minutes. Never mix up, you know, like one drop of it, because you can't get the ratio really accurate that way either. Now, what I'm going to do is let this sit for a few minutes and go into its, what I'll call a cheese state, so it's a little thicker than normal. Probably 2 to 3 minutes is what that needs to do. Then I can start just by taking the least little bit. Boy, you only need a millionth of a drop here. Now what I did, I did all the epoxy in through the back, just dropped it in. I don't want any dripping out on the front. Now what I'm gonna do is put a little piece of scotch tape over this, or masking tape even, just to hold that from coming out. Now, luckily, nothing dropped out on the front here. Now I need to, using this, my ambidextrous ways, before that epoxy kicks off, see if I can drop these in. And as long as they're just touching one millionth of a drop of epoxy, we have it made. It'll stay in there. Now that one went too far in. It looks like I'm gonna have to get one right on top of it, maybe. Ah! Son of a gun went in backwards. Luckily, I have a lot of these. You gotta dump some more out of the pack. Again, this is just one of those little details. Boy, I talk about details. Well, I'll put one on top of the other and hope that I get enough epoxy sitting through there. Now, again, the nice part about this, even if these were not perfect, because I can slide the canopy back and work on them, hey, it's not the end of the world. I can see the epoxy oozing out of there. I'm really trying to do this delicately. I added two more. And what I found I was having better luck doing without the scotch tape was just poking them in this way. Famous last words. Now what I'm going to do is when I get these in place, then I'll add some epoxy from the back. In fact, I can add some over these. Just make sure these are nice and solid. It's
So even though I can get in here and get at these, I'd rather not get in and get at them. I'd rather have them nice and solid. The easiest way I found, and again, I'm in a learning curve here, is to babysit them. You can just kind of, as soon as that epoxy starts to kick off, a couple minutes into it, you can feel it start to get a little skin to it, cheese, whatever you want to call it. Then I can just probe these down. When I was at the Nets, I was looking at some of the, I think it's on the video, too, I was looking at some of the giant scale, especially the Jets, and it was a Sea Fury. And I was looking at the cockpit detail, and the thing I said was, how the hell do they do that? It was amazing. So I'm wondering, maybe somebody will look at this and go, how the hell did he do that? I don't think so. Anyway, this will be an above average cockpit, that's for sure. I want to start thinking about, when I get done with this, babysitting this, I want to think about making up a throttle quadrant. Say that quick 10 times. Throttle quadrant. Okay, you really have to babysit these jewels, but hard to believe we're doing this, but anyway, it will get to the point where the CA starts to kick, or the CA, the epoxy kicks up, and it'll just kind of hang there for about 2 minutes, and you can set it right into the final position. Well, when this epoxy, see, starts to turn to this, now you know. It hardens quicker in big masses, so in a small amount, now I can get a brand new toothpick that isn't all glocked up. Now I know I can get the final set. This will still be a little flexible, a little rubbery. Oh, yes. And if I'm real lucky, I won't push it right out onto the floor. Anyway, this is a nice detail, whether you're even doing a Magnum, a Nobler, or whatever. Those little jewels really add a, like the little lights that are on a dashboard of a real plane. Mixing up a fresh batch because I want to get another coating of epoxy so that these things are contained from the back. Might sound like overkill, but then, hey, a lot easier to do this now than after the plane has 200 flights on it. Yeah, you really love that. I have to tell you, that's one of the things I really love. I was over by Giant Scale RC. They really do cockpit details. Keith Trossel, by the way, had cockpit details. Unbelievable. It really is inspiring to see somebody that's a real modeler do their thing. Now, I can see this from this side. This may sound like a lot of work, but you know what? When you're out at the flying field and you got all these white airplanes with red stripes on them and stars and stuff, and all of a sudden there's something that's just a little bit different. And I guess you need that inspiration or you're really wasting your time. If you're just doing it like it's, you know, like it's working at McDonald's, it isn't worth it. It's got to be that you feel like you're doing something special. Oh man, I like that. What really helps too is this little, I call it a, for lack of a better word, the George eyeglasses here. This really, and that, now I know George uses this when he does this little tiny lettering on his fire engines with a, that they have one hair on the brush and it works well. Now even as blind as I am, this really makes a difference. This is another one of those tools if you don't have one. Once you have it, you're going to wonder, I got to get a new toothpick. Once you have it, you wonder how the hell did I do this stuff without it? Again, I'm looking from every angle here. I want to lay out the throttle quadrant next. Right, I always start with a pin when I make up a throttle quadrant. I'm going to clip off one end of this to start with. Need to slice off a little piece of tubing and put a little bit of a notch in it.
Canopy's easiest to put the notch in first, slide this onto the wire, and then trim it off. Now, of course, all I got to do is just trim this off and fill the tube with thick CA. Now, I always like to just put some thick CA in each end, and then I can clean this all up. Yeah, I just ran over and ran that on a buffing wheel, on a polishing wheel. And now I want to make up the semicircle quadrant that goes in. Just find a piece of scrap quarter inch, I guess, would be a good place to start. And what I need to do is go over to the parting wheel and put a slot in there so it simulates a slot. Okay, now I want to put thin CA over the whole surface of everything and sand it down just to harden up the wood. This is a good way to hold it when you want to put on the thin CA. Put it on real quick with a Q-tip and wipe it right off. This ensures that you'll only need one or two coats of paint when you go to paint this. Let it kick off normally. See what this does? Now I only need one coat of paint to get this to cover. Now there's only one thing that I would suggest if you're going to make a little quadrant like this up. And that is to pin, and I'll show you what I'm talking about. Where's that piece? What I need to do, once I get this painted, I need to bring this through and then put an L-bend on the bottom. If you just stick this in, what happens in time, it'll loosen up and rotate and everything. So I want to paint it first, but I don't want to forget to put that L-bend in there. Now in today's mail, I got a great letter from Steve DiGiulio. Of course, Steve is, his claim to fame is having the world's biggest and most luxurious workshop and the most understanding wife, who comes out and sweeps up his shop at the end of every session. Yeah, I know. Okay, on to business. This is Mike Palko, and notice real quick, it's an electric motor, an electric powered twister. Now, I'm just reading from his note. To prove an electric and stunt, he can fly loops, inverted wing overs, not enough power for overhead eights. Well, Mike, now listen, Mike, I'm really getting excited about this. I don't want to have to tell you again, if you don't have enough power, get a tune pipe. DiGiulio, give him a tune pipe. No problem. Tune pipe electric is the way to go. Now, speaking of tune pipe electric, now this is the best photo I've gotten in a long time. Long time. We all have seen this at the stunt forum. Needless to say, they're using a tune pipe from a motorcycle or a dump truck or something on this. I don't even know what the specs are. I don't even care about the specs because Banjak, you're always trying to outdo me. You're always on the trailing edge of technology. Look, this is not big, Banjak. Small and puny, another small and puny. Look at the wingspan. It's not even as big as they are. Get real. World's biggest flight streak. They crashed it, too. I don't even want to tell you. I'm not going to read the letter till I get some pictures of these guys repairing us. Anyway, the body's made out of solid sheetrock or a bumper from a Kenworth truck or something. Banjak, you'll do anything to outdo Artnowski. I can hear him now. Let's make a triple size flight streak. But you never will. Forget it. DiGiulio put the hex on you. I'll show you what big and tough is. Now look, Banjak, this is big. This is heavy. Notice the plane. Bigger than the man. Look at those muscles. Ooh, nice muscles. Anyway, thanks. Steve, thanks for the pictures. I got to get back to doing this cockpit. I'm making me crazy. I got to make up some little throttles and doodads and who knows what else. Now, here's another unique little product I can't wait to try. It's some of these little parting wheels. It's really made for a quarter inch shaft, but this has been turned down to fit in a Dremel.
In fact, I can't wait to try it. I need, maybe in the course of doing this cockpit, I'll find something to try this on. Anyway, I know those, the wheels that come with the Dremel, they tend to explode in your face half of the time. Nice button screw here, too. But the problem is, I don't know how big of a wheel I'll be able to use here, but I will give them all a try. Anyway, let's get back to doing some detailing here. Enough mail for one day. Years ago, maybe not years ago, maybe right now, everybody used to take these crazy push pins, take the dashboard, and just keep sticking them in until it looked like a pin cushion. And then about halfway through the year, some of the heads would fall off. Some of the other things, these would fall off. They'd be all inside the cockpit like SpaghettiOs by the end of the year. Anyway, we're going to go up to the next level. Banjock, pay attention. Now, if you want to make it even just a little bit more realistic, I don't know if you're going to see this on the macro lens, a pin really doesn't make it. It's, if this was a real throttle, oh, I love that word, throttle quadrant, and you were flying any kind of a plane, this throttle would have a sliding sleeve and a locking nut so you could lock the throttle in position, at least most of the ones that I've had the joy of flying, like the Air Coupe anyway. What I do, I take a little piece of aluminum tubing, slide it over the pin, and just put a drop of CA at each edge, so it kind of locks it in position. So now I can make up as many of these as I think I need. Now what I did, I put another little piece of copper tubing, telescoping tubing, just to simulate, make it a little more realistic than a pinhead. A little idea here, which looks the more realistic. Anyway, in a real Spitfire, or in a real Seafire, or in a real Air Coupe, there's a lot of knobs and switches, and they're purposefully always a little bit different, so that even by feel they're different. If you look at the throttle quadrant on a Piper Cherokee even, all of the knobs and switches and everything have a little bit different feel. The whole idea is that even in the dark or at night or whatever, you'd know by feel as well as by view what they look like. Okay, I like that little throttle. That looks good. Now what I want to do, I want to make up some switches for the dashboard. And I'm going to start with these. These are just heavy-duty pins, thick pins. What I do, I'm going to go over to the grindstone, grind this end off, and smash this end in a hammer. With a hammer, just beat it to death. Remember watching the Nats video, being over by the RC scale and saying, next year I'll have switches. Go back and look at that video and see if I didn't say that. You know what, we're going to have switches. Anyway, you got to beat this a lot flatter than you really expect it to be. The reason being, now you can grind this like a toggle switch. And it really isn't that difficult to do, but it's really a nice scale touch. Now what I need to do is go over by the Dremel tool and radius this off and file it all down nice and smooth. And what I did, I just put these in on an angle with a little baby washer underneath it, and I'll put a drop of CA on it. Now I just hit these with a couple of drops of CA. I'm letting it kick off. What I did, I tried to line them up so they're all roughly at the same angle. In case I want to put them in pairs or in sets, they'll all look similar. By the way, anybody ever had an old Triumph motorcycle, you know about those old Lucas switches, and probably that's what they had on a Spitfire, too. Actually, these look exactly scale. Okay, now obviously when you pull these out, a chunk of wood comes with it. And I have to take these over and clean them up with a razor. But these really did not come out too bad. And now I have a little way, and boy, love that. That is on the video, by the way. Okay, now the only trick is figuring out how we want to mount them. And of course, this is plywood. You really have to put the angle in that you want the switch to set it. If you wanted the switch to be in the up position, put it in on that angle. If it's a neutral switch, this way. Make sure these go all the way through, and then I can just set the switches in. Now what I want to do, I want to get some black dope. While I have the black dope out, I want to paint the switches. I'll also paint that little guy too, get some paint on this. Maybe we can get this assembled soon. Soon, I keep saying soon. Now see, the idea of getting any of these little detail things is to get a lot of different contrast. Now this will be kind of shiny against the dull background when this dries. It'll let it stand out a little bit. What you're looking for is a little bit of contrast, a lot of different textures. Now, I don't know, I think that looks really cute. Okay, Dollhouse King. It's a lot of work making this, believe me. Well, what I'm trying to do is just add a few rivet heads here or something to dress this up before I get ready to install this. Anyway, I can go right around it. Now most of this you're not even going to see, but the little, you never know ahead of time what part you are going to see, so it pays to do it ahead of time. Because once these parts are glued in, it'll be impossible to get in there and do this kind of detailing. It'll really be a pain in the ass, in fact. Do is get, see if I can freehand in some rivets or something in here just to busy that area up, and then I'm going to get ready to put the floor in.
What I'm doing before I assemble this, taking an ink marker and edging off all the plywood edges, because I don't know when I finally get to do the painting, I don't know if I'm going to be able to make a nice joint here, but I know if I have some black ink in there, it'll kind of disguise the joint. It also, the reason I don't want to put paint in there is when I attach the seat back, I want to be gluing onto solid wood. That's going to act as a former in there.
I'm going to leave the wood back here, and this will give me a nice wood joint. When that seat dries, I'll get the glue in there. Give me a good bond. If I paint this edge, I'll never be able to get in there with a brush. There's all kind of little angles in the room. So now all I have to do is paint up to that black edge.
Remember that little throttle quadrant? What I need to do now, the paint is dry, set this in there. Now I also want to, let me get the needle noses here. What I want to do is bend a little hook on this. Now if you don't do this, what happens? And this gets loose with vibration, it'll be rotating. So, kind of like one of those cheap insurance things. Now I can get the handle in exactly the angle I want it in. I can just glue this, let me recess it, in fact. See, by recessing it, now I can just take a drop of CA and hold that right in position. One of those little cheap insurance things. And the first day you don't do that, remember, this is funny, Gene Schaefer had a plane one time, and I mean, he was a killer flyer. He might have been the best flyer of all time, I don't know. They always use his name when they talk about it. But halfway through a flying season, the pilot's head came off. And he'd be, you ever had that little game that's like a maze, and you try to get all the golf balls or whatever they are in position? Well, he was over just before appearance judging, trying to get the pilot's head to jump back up on the body. There's no way. In our case, we'll just slide the canopy back and glue his head back on. Anyway, one more little detail here. I want to do, I want to take some, let me just pinch this up. I want to take some of that Will Hold Tight Bond alphatic resin, paint the back of this, paint inside the fuselage, and just slide this in. The reason for using Tight Bond, if some comes up around the edge, it won't be really too ugly. Here's the best thing is don't even get glue up near the edge. Leave the last little bit without glue. This way, when this gets pressed down, what's going to happen? I don't want the glue to ooze out the sides if I can help it.
Okay, that alphatic should be drying up. In fact, I'm going to take a coffee break. When that alphatic's dry, then I can glue the seat in and start. I can actually start laying some of these parts out today, even though we're at the end, almost at the end of this day.
Well, I did. I glued some little triangular pieces so that once this sits down in the fuselage, this will complete the box of the former just to add a little strength, just so it isn't going along for the ride. It really will act as really will. Like a half a former anyway.
Okay, that seat is glued in. I glued this little guy in. I see, with that glued at the bottom like that and glued at the top, this actually becomes a former. Rather than just going along for the ride, make sure I haven't got any glue in there. The glue should be dry holding that in. Nothing oozed up over the edge. The last thing tonight is we're going to get the pilot in, and that's it. Hey, time to go to sleep here, boy.
Put me in that plane right now.
Now, I had to make some kind of a little support because I don't want, what will happen is I don't want him all the way down on the floor. I want him up just a little bit, so I wanted to make a little perch. I made up a soft piece of scrap ball, so I want to make sure, first of all, I don't want to see him go parachuting out of here on the first square eight either, because don't forget, with the cockpit open, he may go for a ride. Now I want to trim these off, because I want to use the back of his head as a perch too. I'm going to leave them larger than they have to be and then just keep block sanding them down until I get him right in the location I'd like to have him in. Now every time I put him in there, I just take a little more off.
I'm not going to get to put the pilot in tonight. I didn't get enough time to get him shimmed. And it's time for that wonderful favorite part of my life, supper. Anyway, we didn't get him done. I need to spend a little time shimming him, and then we'll work on it tomorrow. There's a lesson there too, is don't rush these things. I want him in there nice and straight.
All right, today in the mail, I got a couple of nice photos here from David Thompson from Wauhatchie. I guess it's Wisconsin. I can't read the last name. No, Washington, Wisconsin. Yeah, knows what he's doing, right? Anyway, in the middle of all this, I want you to see the caption. It's a Calamity Jane flown at the 95 Nats, Fox 35S, sandcast, now is refinished, Tom Dixon, 40. Second picture, McCoy 35 in picture, flew best with a sand cast Fox 35. Anyway, thanks to David for the photos, and obviously I'll pass them on to Stunt News. Now for some really cool stuff. Now, check this out. Anyway, there's a little story to this. My wife and I go out antique shopping, and of course in the mall where all the antique dealers are, there's a place that sells dollhouse supplies. So B and I built her the dollhouse, and I'm interested in it. While she went out looking at antique furniture, I went to the dollhouse store, and I got two things that absolutely look, can't see with my glasses or whatever. Two things I know you're gonna be impressed. Now look, Adamusco impressed me last year. I got to see his plane for the first time totally finished, and it had a little Stunt News on the pilot seat. Well, Adamusco, you've been one-upped. You've been, if I could ever open a package, I know what they nail us on. Anyway, what I got this guy, now check this out. This is really, really unusual. There's a little tiny, let's see if I can show this up close. A little tiny thermos bottle with a hot cup of coffee, of course, for his trip across the Atlantic into Berlin. And check this out. And it even has the back. I don't know if you can see this. Maybe I ought to put this on a macro lens. Now look at this. Now tell me this isn't cool. A little thermos and a little Tony's pizza. So the guy doesn't, well, I hope I didn't wreck it. He doesn't have to go off the war without a slice of pie and a hot thermos, and I'm sure he has vodka in this thermos. Anyway, when we do get to work on this thing, and tomorrow is the Super Bowl, so we're not going to work on it tonight or tomorrow. We're going up to have a big Super Bowl party. Nude mud wrestling and all. Hey, see you Monday after the Super Bowl. Now, believe me, I ran into what I hope isn't going to be a big problem here. But it certainly is something I have to be aware of. When I make the pilot, the height, now see, I had to channel out a little bit of his front here for the push rod. When I get him the height I want, what happens is other things get in the way. His shoulders rub on the sliding canopy mechanism. So keep in mind, I'm trying to do the sliding canopy that goes right around his shoulders. I'm sinking him down in. So what I've been doing is, and I've replaced these pieces of wood about 6 times already, sanding, until I just get him at the right height. This really is taken. This is Super Bowl Sunday, and I'm trying to get this done before the Super Bowl starts. Obviously not having a lot of success. But anyway, I'm going to just sand little by little by little now until I get him to just drop down. I don't want him rubbing on a push rod. I even ground away some of his hand. And then I want to get this, well, I love this little thermos. I want to see if I have all this stuff that I can put it in there. Tell you what the problem really is here, because you may run into this, who really knows. You push this forward, whoop, it hits. So it means what I have to do is lower him, lower and lower. Now see, I've got him offset. And what happens is, because of the way I mounted these posts, I'm actually working in the very corners of the cockpit where that radius, that internal fillet is mounted. So I'm just grinding away little by little by little until I get a final, what I hope is going to be a final fit on this guy. But I want to be able to slide these forward and not have it run into the pilot's shoulders. I've got it almost perfect. In fact, what I decided to do is just let this, come on, sit straight. I'm going to put this in with slow drying epoxy. And I want these things to actually hold him centered. And I can press him all the way down. I want to make sure his head is lined up with the headrest, of course. This is really taking a lot more time than I thought it would. But you know what? I think all these little clearances and things are going to pay off in the final result is this is really going to look nice. And boy, Georgina did some job here. It's an unbelievable job. Now, I'm not taking any chances. What I'm doing here is I'm putting on a little bit of carbon fiber reinforcement onto the little pieces of wood that hold the pilot in, just as overkill. Best things is when this guy sits in here, I can't show this on the camera conveniently, you can still see just a little bit of the wood. So what I'm going to do, even after the carbon fiber's on it, I want to just touch that with a little bit of black dope with some talcum powder in it so it kind of fades in. It doesn't stand out. Now what I'm making up here, and this is something you might want to use, in fact we may use this again and again, I'm taking a little bit of the black dye from the epoxy and some 5-minute epoxy. The idea of having black epoxy is if you do get to see some of this oozing out somewhere, it won't be that glocky color that you see. It'll kind of hide itself, even though I'm going to be real careful not to get this smeared all over the place. This is an old trick from Ski Dombrowski. He made his own epoxylite this way. I'm going to try to put a glob on here. And of course, I'm going to have to babysit it. I'm also going to put a dot right on the back of his helmet after this dries. So he's in a three-point stance. Sounds like football, huh?
Just put me in and shut up, Rutnowski.
Now, what's real helpful here, believe it or not, is a flashlight to look down and see what parts of this you can and cannot see. So I put plenty of epoxy in there. I don't want this sucker to come out. I put plenty up on the post and then just let it drool down and make a nice fillet. Now I slide the things up, they'll hold him in position. And again, check with the flashlight just to make sure. So I just put one drop of 5-minute epoxy behind his head. Remember, I'm using this backdrop as actually a way of holding the pilot in place. And boy, there is nothing, especially if you glue a cockpit on, there's nothing worse than having a pilot come mock a rainer and right out halfway through the season. The neat little trick is the little epoxy that I have left over to clear, I'm just taking and putting one little tiny drop on the end of each one of the switches, make it a little more realistic. I think that'll dry with a little shine. Now I still have to make sure once that dries that I can slide these without a problem. Just going to wait for everything to dry up here before I go on to the next step. Now what I'm going to do, I figured out where exactly I want to put this little thermos bottle. And it's difficult because what I want to do is where the pilot ends and the floor begins, there's a little gap, and this will kind of conceal a gap. It's almost like doing a little bit of a magic trick. Now what I want to do is I want to see the, by the way, these are the little John Pothier scissors. Oh, hey, I remember you. Thanks to John for these. And this is really an invaluable tool when you're going to do little baby work like this. And what I try to do is let the epoxy just go before it turns into cheese, about 3 minutes into mixing it. And then it doesn't drip and drool all over the sandpaper in there and everything. Again, I don't want to see the epoxy coming off the end of this. Now the trick here is to, I already put a blob of epoxy down in there. Now the idea is to use this to cover up a spot to complete the illusion. Again, that the pilot is not. I see we still need some clearance between the push rod and this. I'm going to have to get in there with an X-Acto knife or something and get some clearance in there.
And so the pilot's got his own little thermos of vodka there. Kind of like that.
The trick to cleaning out, there's two choices I have. That,
come on, these blades are a pain in the ass.
I need to get in by that. Look at these two blades glued together. I don't believe this. I need to get in where the push rod is rubbing. Now I have two choices. I can put a piece of sandpaper in there and let it grind away, or I can get in there with a brand new blade. And I think because that plastic is real soft, I can just cut away just enough that I have absolutely no interference.
Now the nice thing is if next year, and we've already talked about this, if we make the Mark 21, the wing will be lower in the body and it'll have dihedral, so the wing can be at a lower position. It'll give us a lot more room to do fancy cockpit details. And Now, the last thing is I want to find a spot for Tony's Pizza in there. I don't even know if we're going to be able to use this, but let me give it a shot. I like it. What I want to do, I want to make two little side panels that drop down here with some switches or something on them, and then I'm going to make a hood that has a little bit of a curve in it up here to try to get it a little more scale-like. By the way, that little trick with the epoxy on the switches made them look very plastic, like the real ones, like old Lucas switches. Love the way the little red lights turn on and off.
I will understand.
Step one is to laminate up some cross grain, 64th, not really important which way the grains go. Two layers of 64th will be just enough to hold the switches in place. Always a little bit easier, because this is going to wind up being a real tiny piece to do. Put all the holes in it, all the switches, dials, whatever's going to go in here, before you cut it off the piece. That's really a good tip. Now, I smashed up some extra switches just to get some idea how I want to lay this out. Again, since I don't have a firm picture in my mind, I'm kind of doing this as I go along. Now, I want to get a rough idea of the length here. Six. Put up the first piece of plywood here. But I did get what I hope is going to be a usable piece here. Got the parts, just a dot of CA on. See, what I try to do is build up a fillet of glue on the back, thick CA, so that has some support so the switches don't start moving after the plane's a year or two old. I put a couple of thin coats of CA on here. I just want to seal this wood. I'm not going to be able to do the actually painting this until I get the further on in the thing, because I want to make a hood for over the instruments, and I want to make this have the same color, same texture. Now it needs a little bit of sanding and dressing off before I put this in place. Well, 15 minutes from now, the Super Bowl is going to start. And Karen's got all these good snacks and chocolate chip cookies and everything up there. So I'm going to put the paint on this, come back to it tomorrow. Of course, we're rooting for Bill Parcells, Patriots, but they are the underdog. Hey, why do I always root for the underdog? I never can figure this out. Well, for once, I just root for the team that's favored, and then maybe I'd win once in a while. Anyway, go New England. Go Midgley. Go somebody. Go Parcells. Okay, that's a concoction of, I guess, all the stuff that we have here is talcum powder and some black Sig dope. I want that to dry. Then I'll try to accent the little switch tips with a glob of epoxy or something. I laid this all out in the cockpit there before. It looked pretty good. See you tomorrow.
Okay, go Patriots! Go Patriots! Yay, yay, Patriots! Oh no!
Hey, Super Bowl food, look at these goodies. Oh my God. There's my chocolate turtle. What else are you making in here?
Wontons.
Noel Drindak says send them up some of this stuff.
Wontons.
Oh my God, look at the chunk.
Is this spanakopita?
I'm going to get so fat I won't be able to go to the Nationals. Spanakopita.
You said you wanted hors d'oeuvres, so this
was
your...
I want fattening food. Look at this. How are you supposed to enjoy the Super Bowl party without fattening food? Fattening hot dogs, chocolate? Howdy, halftime and not all the food is eaten.
That's okay.
Put a hole in the half.
New England 14.
Oh, the Patriots are losing. Bob, give me my money back. We better eat some more. All right, I guess you know the Patriots didn't win, but I'm going to check that my pilot epoxy's all dry. Oh, yes. Well, there's always next year. Just wait till next year. Anyway, we'll see you tomorrow when we get a little bit of the indigestion out of us. Okay, this morning, you see, I wanted to show you that the difference in the contrast between the flat paint and the little switches with the little drops of epoxy on them really does make it look like the Lucas switches or whatever Ducati switches, who the hell knows what they are. Anyway, what I want to do now, I want to drill some holes right above this and put in some of the little red. We have 3 jewels left. I can get 3 jewels in there. That'll kind of be like the indicator lights. Again, this is kind of fantasy stuff, but again, I think it will dress it up just a bit. Right, now I'll set the jewels in the same way with some slow drying epoxy, some 5-minute epoxy. Just put a drop in there with a toothpick, then set them in from the back and try to set them so they all reflect at about the same angle. Hey, next time I go down to this little craft place, it's called Michael's. I should have bought these in a whole bunch of different colors. They had all different colors. I only bought red. Yeah, same old trick, just like I did on the dashboard. Just pick them up with the tip of a toothpick that's wet. Later on today, or sometime today, I'm going to go through that Nats video and see. I know it's on this part where we went to the scale hanger where I saw all those little switches. I don't really know if I can take any credit for this. Not really. Anyway, I still have a good indigestion from all those hot dogs yesterday. Oh man, pizza and hot dogs. Now I can just put a little blob of epoxy on the back and then I have to set them. As the epoxy starts to cure off, take a pin and just make sure that they're all the same distance out. You don't have one kind of in and one out. That don't look too bad. You can just adjust them now. As this epoxy starts to cure, you can just set them. It's a little too soft now. Get the final set on each one of them. Okay, what I tried to do is locate the switches here. Now I want to make that little piece that's going to feel like an eyelet, a hood over here. I need to lay that out next. What I did, I just as a test here to see how this would work, I mixed up some 5-minute epoxy. This is already dry. With a little bit of black dye in it. What I wanted to do with that, I wanted to make the switches even shinier, and I'm really convinced that was worth the extra little effort. Again, it's just epoxy dye mixed in with the epoxy, and it really did set the switches off, I guess. And I'm trying to figure out, you know, from looking in the lens, if you can see it in the macro lens. But that really does look like it added a little bit of realism to it anyway. Now the next thing I want to do, I want to lay out this little hood with a little piece of cardboard. I don't want to trim any of this down. This is all sticking up a little bit, and I'm probably going to have to grind it back down. But I want to lay this hood out with a little bit of a radius in here, and a little bit of just something to busy this little area up, because this is what you'll see through the bulletproof glass. What I did, I made up this little, I don't know what lever it simulates, but there's a lever on the floor of the Seafire, just like it. Made it up with what amounted to be a 440 blind nut that had rounded edges. I don't know what they used that for. It was in my junk box. A piece of tubing and one of those little lever things. And you can see from being a pin to that, what looks more realistic, you know? This was one of the extra ones we had. Now this little lever, I don't know what lever it is, see? Nobody knows, it's a secret, but anyway, I stuck it down there. I made the pinhole in the floor, I just want to put a little bit of epoxy. I don't want to have a big blob on here.
It's not just sentimental.
To where John Pothier scissors, those little things that he gave me came in handy. In fact, I see I got a little bit too much epoxy on here.
See where I got that. It's almost in a semi-scale spot too. By the way, that little extra epoxy on the switches really, I think, helped it out too. All right, let's get laid. I've been trying to put off laying out this hood because I know it's a pain in the neck.
Now, I spent quite a bit of time getting this blended in just so the hood would fit. Hood. A little piece of wood that's going to go over here to fit perfectly flush. This little pattern up, and it was what I did is I gauged where it was too small and not wide enough, so I just traced this down on here. Now what I want to do is get all the radiuses in equal before I cut this out, and I can kind of pick the radius I want here when I rough this out. Again, the same thing as any other pattern making. This just makes it a little bit easier, somewhat easier anyway, to get the radiuses in right. Again, with each little detail that I add, it just takes on a little bit of a life of its own. And it really is getting to be fun to work on. Now that we've got most of the big stuff out of the way, putting in all the little final details really is a lot of fun. Just like making a dollhouse, in fact. Ask Adam Musco, he made one. He really did, too. You can see where I added a little bit of material just to make it wider than it has to be, and then I want to taper it in. Now, before I put this in, I want to just take an ink marker and darken up the bottom, because I'm not going to be able to get in there conveniently with any kind of a paintbrush or anything. I want to do the edges too. This part you probably won't see it, but just in case you do, I want to have this edge blacked in.
I marked out where this is going to go, so I want to get an even distribution of the glue in there. I don't want to have the glue oozing out in all possible ways. Yeah, this was the thing I was talking about, the improvement in the gun sights. And you can see the old to the new. And what they did with these, they dialed in the wingspan of the plane. Notice the bulletproof glass here. Anyway, I'm trying to simulate this up, trying to make up a thing from a couple pieces of scrap wood. You can see how that looked up through a side view. I just took this as just a little piece of scrap wood, and I've been dinkering around here trying to figure a way. I want to make a little piece of glass here, and I don't know what. I'm trying to do this piece by piece, and it's not easy. What I did, I took an eyelet, a small eyelet, and put some cuts in it to try to make the adjusting knob. It looks like it's a knob on the side of that anyway. Somebody breaking into the house here? I see the pumpkin just went off. Oops. Okay, after what amounts to be a half an afternoon of trying to figure out, I tried to take a grindstone, trying to make a simulation of this, what really is a gun sight, and I made this little, it looks like an ice scraper out of a piece of canopy material. I don't know if you're going to be able to see this until it's all completed. But that does have something like the side view look, and that's about as elaborate as it's going to get of the late model gun sight. Now what I did, I made up three of these sight windows. I'm not really happy with any of them. I want to get the, again, I'm trying for that look, because it can't be exactly scale. I've had them just tack glued in place, and I'm not happy with any of them really yet. I need to get that look that you're looking up through that glass. Now, last night was a complete blowout. We had company here. We had people over. Jimmy, George, everybody eating pizza and burping and everything. Didn't get my little gun sight finished. Wound up making 10 pieces of glass. None of them looked right. So I got frustrated and just put it away. Open up the mail this morning. And this is from Bill Farmer. Now, Bill Farmer, the last time I wrote him a letter, I think, and we exchanged things. I think I did send him a picture of my little steam train ride. Anyway, I mentioned it. And he sent me this. Now, look at this real carefully. This is a once-in-a-lifetime thing. This is the J, the Norfolk and Western J. And he's gone on several steam tours. He sent a nice letter, too, and I'm going to return some pictures, and maybe I'll even ask him if he's interested in that video that I made on a trip. But anybody that knows about trains knows about it. I'm sure Noel Drindak is drooling right now. This is Drindak, eat your heart out. This is the Norfolk and Western Mallee. Now, he sent a couple of pictures. He was on this train, 1218. Now, when I was a kid, I had a Rivarosi model of this. And this is one. You can't imagine. In fact, Bill put it in his letter. You can't imagine how big this thing is in real life. Now, this summer, we plan on going up by Noel Drindak, and he's told me of lots of neat steam train-related things. So we're going to try to hit all of them, maybe even in conjunction with Scott's Miss Contest. But just check this out. I mean, talk about a voice from the past. This is really, really nice. Bill, really appreciate the exchange of pictures. I'm going to dig through my album, see if I can get you some stuff. Really, really get excited about steam trains. I don't know why. I guess I'm just getting old. I'm only kidding. I am old. Anyway, thanks a lot, Bill Farmer. When I last left this, what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to get the look. Obviously, I'm limited in some ways. I'm trying to get the look of, I cut these out of canopy material. And what I really would like to have most of all is that from the side view, it looked similar to what this will look like. But the difficult part is the real gun sight has a knob on the front, kind of like a knob you would turn an alarm clock on with. And I'm trying to figure if I can use this material or something to simulate that knob. And I just tried to put in some details with a grindstone. I put an eyelet over here with some saw cuts in it. Again, making these little details is certainly not my forte in life, but I'm learning real quick. One of the things you need to have is tweezers, and you need to, every time you do something with thin CA, you need to make sure your fingers aren't within 100 miles of it. I've glued my finger to the glass, I've glued my finger to this, and this is just a piece of aluminum tubing I sawed off. This really gets to be a labor. You can see how big this is relative to my thumb. But I think it is a detail that when you look into a cockpit where the thing is slit open, anybody who knows about Spitfires is going to pick it up right away, and it will be worth the extra effort.
It better be, Art Nowski. I'll put you on a steam train. You'll be shoveling coal all day.
Anyway, hey, thanks a lot again to Bill Farmer for those photos. They're great. And this is the knob I'm trying to simulate. I know everybody out there is probably saying, oh yeah, that's easy, just do this, just do that. Try doing it. It's really difficult. Now, believe it or not, on the end of this, John Papia says, what I've been trying to do is come up with that knob. It looks like this might be a way of doing it. What I did is took one of the Midgley canopies and took a bite out of the back of it. Again, this is it's impossible for me. I'm not used to working with little tiny things. But I want to glue this in place with some slow drying epoxy. Maybe some 5-min would be better. Just get it in place. But to try to do this with CA, you know what's going to happen. Goodbye, your whole hand is glued to the piece. Believe me, I've had the worst experiences in the world trying to do these little details with CA. I don't know, there's probably a trick I don't know about Bill Boss, or if George Gatiss was alive, he'd know, but the only way I've been able to work neatly is with the epoxy.
Now this is really, these John Papia scissors, there's no substitute for these when you need to hold little things. If you're trying to do this little detail work, I guess, see, if I was going to do this more often, I guess I'd go get a set of dental instruments or something, that little tiny scissors and pliers and stuff. but these have really proven invaluable. There's no way you can hold a piece this small. You need tweezers and you need all kind of little gizmos. But anyway, these work well. Now I got the epoxy and I'm waiting for it to almost kick off till it's almost in that gel state so this will stay in position. And I'm going to try to glue this piece in a windshield, that little glass shield, in at the same time. This ought to be fun. You can see this, and it's certainly not, the epoxy's still a little bit too soft. Again, epoxy, this is the biggest thing I've learned so far, is that these details, you need epoxy, not CA. Install a little gun sight, what I want to do is get the flat black part of this all painted in. That'll be easier to paint now than after this is all put together. By the way, that's not looking too bad down there. I don't say so myself. Georgina, you're okay. I don't care what they say about you. Yeah, that's good.
To make up for doing inside, this is going to be flat black. I need to mix my own flat black. I think you can still buy. They make dull colors. But I'm just not in the mood, and especially with a snowstorm on its way here, I'm not in the mood to run down a hobby shop to see if they have any flat. But if you want to make your own flat anti-glare black, the easy way to do it, mix up some black and some thinners till it's kind of on the thin side. This is really kind of easy to do. Don't overdo the talc. And what I'll do is just paint this up in the area. Now it's easier to paint this before I put the little gun sight on, otherwise I'm never going to get the paint around that gun sight. It's going to be very difficult to do that. And anything in front of a pilot would tend to be anti-glare black. You wouldn't find polished, buffed out Imron in front of a pilot, because if you've ever been a pilot of a real plane, you know you look out the front of a plane and all you see is reflections, especially up in the glass area. So this is a good test. If it drips off your brush about like that, that's real good.
Still have the faint outline of where I had the canopy on here. What I'm going to do is put the canopy back on and retrace this, trying not to put a dent in the wood so that I don't want to see this in the final product. But I'll bring the paint just a little bit further out than where that is, so that if I decide to move the canopy a little bit further back, I'll have some fine tuning to do.
Now, I don't know where this parting line for the paint is going to be, so I'll go just a little bit further. That'll be close enough to get me where I want to go. Again, the easiest way is with these, I don't know what you call them, the George goggles. These seem to be the best way, the best tool you have for doing this little close-up work. Of course, it's even better if you happen to have good eyesight, which I don't.
Now, usually you need at least 3 or 4 coats of this kind of paint. And so I don't try to glob it on. The best thing is to do is get the first coat on thin so you get some decent adhesion. Many times I've tried to thicken up the paint with so much talc that it was like putty. Doesn't work. Need to get a coat on. You can see how thin this is. Let it dry for an hour or so, a couple hours. Get another coat on. Eventually it's going to have to be sanded a little bit. But you certainly don't have to worry about doing the same finish as we're going to do out here, where you're going to have glass and tissue and everything. This is just a cosmetic, really just like the pilot. A lot easier, again, to do this before that gun sight is installed, too.
Yeah, this is going to need probably 2 or 3 more coats, but I get the first coat. The trick is get the coat on wet so you get that good adhesion.
Now, while that's drying, I wanted to take what I've done in the past on pilots is where their goggles are. I've mixed up some real thin 5-minute epoxy and just taken a toothpick and tried to get it on to simulate glass. Now, it looks like George might have already done this, but I might have distorted it with my own fingerprints, squeezing it and forcing him in. So I'm going to take and mix up a little batch, try to get the eyeglasses to kind of reflect the same way the red jewels do. Again, the trick here that I know of from the past is just babysit the epoxy for a few minutes, try to keep it from getting a run out onto the part of the pilot that's dull. Again, I hope George isn't mad at me for adding this little detail to his pilot. This is some pilot, believe me. He did a heck of a job. And he is a true modeler, and when I say that, I mean it
it's not only that his interests are, you know, building a stunt plane. He has modeling skills beyond that. We've seen on the video some of his cars, race cars, RC planes. He is just a multi-talented person, like many people in the world of stunt. You also can get the pupil of the eye with the tip of a Q-tips here. If this doesn't run, it'll really be effective. It always has that. If you go back and look at the Sidewinder pilot, it always looks like he's looking at you. And my eyes are getting so bad here that I really need these magnifiers. And you can see the reflection, how it contrasts from shiny to dull. Look at all that's drying. What I'm doing, I'm setting up to dye the canopies. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to leave two of them clear, and I'm going to dye two of them. The object of this is if I screw one up, I'll have a match set. Without having to go back and dye it. Rip dye, this is going to be evening blue. I don't know how this is going to look, but even if I make them a little lighter than I expect, again, it looks like in some of the photos, some of the Seafires had a blue tint to the canopy. It may be green, blue-green, reflection of the water, I don't know. You want to get the water, what I do is put real hot water in here, then it takes less time for it to boil when you put it on a stove. Now what the idea is to get it just to come out just a little below boiling. If it's boiling, the canopy is going to go, it wants to be just, when you see the first bubble coming up in there, cut off time. You have to do this kind of babysitting it. Now the trick is, this water is really too hot to touch already. I'm just going to get my hand, ooh. Is to just dunk one of the canopies in, just let it sit for a few minutes. The minute you see a bubble boiling, you know that's as hot as it has to be. Then I'll take the dye, put it in, and stir it up. Keep in mind, this will be, it's dangerous to stick your hand in it once this really gets too hot. One of those jobs, one of many jobs I have to do when Karen's not home, because I use a good pot, see, and she thinks like the dye that's usually left in a pot. I usually try to clean it pretty good, but she catches me once in a while. Anyway, trick number one, don't use a wooden spoon. The spoon will be blue when you're done, or green. Use a metal ladle, stir the dye. Number two, it's red hot, don't burn yourself, don't get your hands in there. And if in doubt, leave it in less than you think it should be, because if you make it too dark, you can't undo it. If it's too light, you can always dunk it back in. You can always go buy another thing of dye, but you really don't want to make it a more intense color than you think it should be. In this case, we just want the slightest hint of blue. Try to replicate what we have in the color photos. What handy to have is a pair of these tongs so you can dunk it in and out from time to time. Usually it'll take only a minute or two in this when the temperature is right, and that's already too hot to put your hand in. I'm going to do a little test and make sure it's just coming up on the temperature right now. But what happens, as you come up on the temperature where the dye normally takes, it'll all of a sudden start to turn blue. But you want to watch, you got to constantly monitor this, make sure it doesn't get darker than you want it to be. The paper towels, it does it to your hands, it does it to anything this dye touches. So the trick is to get this done and get it out of the pan and clean the pan and get rid of all the dye. This stuff, once you get it on your clothes, your watch, anything, it dyes everything. It's tenacious stuff. Once the water gets near that point that it's boiling, it's best to keep the thing moving around. Otherwise, you just wind up with an uneven dye. I guess circulating the dye is what really happens when you do that. You see the air bubbles stick to it and everything. In the Spitfire, I just wanted a hint of tinted glass. I don't want this to look like some drug dealer limo, you know, with the blacked out windows. And I don't want it to hide the details either, so I'm being real careful, just taking it in and out, letting it find its own depth of color, if that's the right way. It's already taken on some color. If it's too hot, what you'll see, the first thing is it'll start to curl up the material. So I'm just constantly looking at it. If I see this material starting to curl up and distort, I got to pull it out, and that means the dye is too hot. it's already just, what I do is I compare it to the clear canopy, and I can see the color. Don't forget the color goes through two pieces of glass as you look through, and that's the reason I don't like to make it any darker than what looks dark up here. When you put it out in the sun, it'll be twice as dark because you're looking through two pieces of glass.
And see the steam coming off the pot. When you see the steam, you're not far from having the bubbles. And as soon as the bubbles start, then you want to monitor it by every second. You don't want that in boiling water.
The edges of the material starting to distort now. Now that we know the temperature is too hot, I got to kill a flame. Right there, we're at the point that this material will start to distort. You can see I got a little bit of a, you got to hold it by a clear one so you can see the difference. And that's all I want. I don't want it to be a whole lot darker than that. So now, because I want to have a backup canopy, I hope this one will go in a minute or two. You can see the steam coming off of here, in fact. I want to make two of them. Now this one will go a lot faster. The other one took about 5 minutes in the dye, but because the dye is a lot hotter now, since I can't walk away from this one.
I hold that up against something white, I can see the difference. See, when you're looking this way, you only look through one layer of glass, but when the plane is flying, you'll see two. You're actually looking through two layers. So definitely, if in doubt, make it lighter than you think it should be. You'll always be safe. Okay, obviously the next thing is I have to trim all this extra plastic off. But what I did, the other one I made up, I'm not happy with it, bellied in on the side. I just got the dye just a little bit too hot. So again, I talked to Dave Midgley, of course, always good to have the input from other people. He called while I was dyeing these canopies, and one of the things he suggested, and I'm going to give it a try, is he says just let the dye sit. Now I'm letting it cool off. Let it sit overnight and just put a canopy in overnight in room temperature. So we'll see how that works, but we'll get back to this tomorrow. I'm just letting it cool off now.
Now these scissors, I don't know what you call these. I happen to have these in my collection and stuff. They have a blunt point. These seem to be real handy for trimming a canopy. These scissors here, you never seem to be able to get in the corners or the edges with. These are real handy for this kind of trimming. And then I'll get the final little bit with a Dremel sanding drum. You can see, I think I got the tint just about right here.
See how much I have to take off here, but I've been doing it in little slivers. I want that front piece to just drop right down.
You mean gecko? Don't lose
that. Get a rough alignment here, the same way we put the block on the back. If I just hold this up over here, it's going to give me a rough idea where I have to Dremel away to. Whoop, I slipped on that one. Now, obviously, I just want to go up to the line, check it, back to the line, check it a couple of times. You can see I got just a little more to take off. Again, sheetrock work. Just take a little more off the front. Still need a little bit more. Just 64th more. A little sliver off of this side, and I think we'll have it.
I want to dress off all these edges. The most important thing is I want to get all these perfect because I'm going to set them down into a ditch. By the way, that paint is almost dry. I'll be ready to get another coat on there real soon. And maybe we can even get this front glued in today. They're really expecting a lot of snow today, so I don't want to get too committed into anything in case I have to go into snowblower mode here. Trimming this last little bit, it's real difficult to do it anyway other than with a sanding, a flat sanding block. What I want to do is get both edges even, because as this slides back, I don't want to have one side higher than the other.
I want to just sand this down and get another coat on here. I'm going to take a break for lunch, so this can be drying while I'm having lunch. And that'll be probably two or three coats will do it, but each coat needs to be rough sanded. This is 320. Again, I'm trying to fill the grain here with a reasonable amount of talc so it doesn't come back through. Okay, the next step I did, and I think I've run into a problem that's going to need some solving, is when I get the canopy lined up to the alignment I want with the fuselage, what happens, this piece gets very, very thin. You can see half of it is already sanded right through. So I'm looking at doing this in some different way, and I don't know exactly how right now. But in the meantime, while I'm engineering that up, I can take and paint what's going to be the rest of the flat black area, so I may as well get one coat on there, and that's a good investment in time right now. That can be drying while I look at how else I can make these out of little pieces of brass or something. Haven't really thought about it yet, but these are the kind of things you don't, until you do it, you think, oh yeah, that'll just work that way, and then you come out, oh, I didn't think of that. Well, this is one of those things now. I made these little wooden pieces up, not realizing how, when they were sanded really thin, they really do get flimsy. Well, that's about all we're going to get done. We're at the end of this tape, and I hope you've picked up some good ideas for your next cockpit detail. This is certainly a lot of fun, and it's certainly challenging. Next time I get to shoot some video, I got to figure out what I want to do with this. I don't know what you want to call it, the slider or whatever. Anyway, this was an adventure, and I guess that's what model aviation always is. Anyway, see you on the next tape. Said before, a nice cockpit.